as much. Just that Robert, my brother, had got this grant to do some kind of work out there. That's the last we heard. It's not knowing that's the worst.
If I were to say I'd noticed anything unusual, it would really only be with hindsight. There was nothing strange about her behavior. She simply disappeared.
It makes no sense. I mean, how can people just vanish off the face of the earth in this day and age? We've a right to know what's going on.
Those people you've just seen have all lost someone close to them. A relative, a colleague, a friend. Lost in mysterious circumstances, sudden and inexplicable disappearance without trace. If you're wondering what this sort of story, important and even tragic though it may be, has to do with Science Report, well, we have to go back in time some 18 months when we began work on another film which examined the scientific brain drain from Britain.
That film was never completed because our inquiries led us into some strange and unexpected byways. And they, in their turn, led uniformly to a blank wall. A blank wall below where I'm standing now at the car park of Terminal 3 of London's Heathrow Airport. We begin this special report with part of that uncompleted film from our reporter, Colin Benson.
Dr. Anne Clark, who works in this building, is one of Britain's younger generation of research scientists. Her speciality is solar energy. Like many others in her position, Anne Clark is contemplating joining the brain drain and leaving the country.
Well, it's entirely a question of facilities. I mean, look at the mess I'm supposed to work out of. Look at this building. If I and people like me are going to do the job we've been trained to do and are capable of doing, then we must be given the means of doing it.
It's looking far better today.
Shortly after this film was taken, Anne Clark made a decision. It was not, however, a decision she felt able to talk about.
Anne, they won't let us into the building. They say they've had orders not to.
Yes, I know, I'm sorry.
Well, can you tell us exactly what's going on?
No, I'm sorry, I can't go on with the film. I'm going away.
What exactly is happening?
I can't say anything.
That is the last piece of film we have of Dr. Anne Clark.
What was going on brought Anne Clark here to the car park of number 3 terminal, Heathrow Airport. She told friends she was going to New York.
British Airways to New York, flight 501. Passengers should go through passport.
And yet there's no record of Anne Clark leaving this airport on that or any other day. The only evidence she was here at all is her abandoned car. Beyond that, nothing.
Well, I've done everything I can to try to get some kind of answer, but there's nothing. They just say, we're sorry, but we don't know anything about your brother.
Robert Patterson is, or rather was, a senior lecturer in mathematics at St. Andrews University. These photos were taken by his sister when he, with his wife Eileen and two children, left this house on the morning of November the 9th, 1975, and set out by car to London's Heathrow Airport. What happened after that? We don't know.
On leaving the Royal Air Force, where he worked in special projects, Brian Pendlebury had told his parents that he was going to work for an electronics firm in Sydney, Australia. He sent photographs of his life out there, and for a time kept in touch by letter.
Then there was this friend of hers who was going out there, and we said, why don't you look up O'Brien and give him a surprise? Well, he got there, the address was given him. They never heard of Brian.
Despite the letters and photographs, which remain unexplained, there's no further evidence about Brian Pendlebury other than the fact that his name appears to have been checked in at London's Heathrow Airport for a flight to Sydney. That, so far as we can discover, is the last anyone ever saw of him.
Anne Clark, Robert Patterson, and Brian Pendlebury. Just three of the 400 names compiled for our projected science report, Brain Drain from Britain. From this office, our researchers began checking through every one of them. We were looking for patterns. Who were the people leaving this country? What were their reasons? And what were their feelings about it afterwards? But out of those 400 names, it became apparent that 24 had disappeared without trace. Some alone, others with their families. Where did they go? And why? And indeed, how? What, if anything, was the common factor?
Jodrell Bank radio telescope, where, although no one realized it at the time, the second part of our complex story was beginning to unfold. Sir William Ballantyne, distinguished radio astronomer, was setting out on a journey he was never to complete. Valentine was a worried man. That much we know from a phone call he made from this isolated box, not far from the main London motorway. He called an old friend, news agency managing editor John Hendry. And how did he seem to you?
He sounded agitated, which was unusual, because he was a very calm, self-possessed man normally. He said he was driving up to London and wanted to see me later. I said, fine. And he also asked if I'd received a package, which he'd posted the day before. I said, I have. It contained this spool of tape, which he told me to keep under lock and key till he arrived. Well, I waited. And, of course, next morning I heard about the accident.
These photographs of the crash were taken by an agency cameraman. Despite considerable news coverage, only one photo was made available to the national press and television. Our own independent experts examined those photographs and the site of the accident itself, where I'm standing now. They drew no firm conclusions, except to say that the cause of the accident remained, to them at least, peculiarly unclear.
But what of the videotape, which Ballantyne had been so anxious to get safely to his friend John Hendry? Apparently nothing. No picture, just the ceaseless noise of space. No different from countless other tapes in the archives of radio astronomy. There was, we were assured, no solution here to the mysteriously violent death of Sir William Ballantyne. But what it meant? What was the piece of vital information Sir William Ballantyne had deciphered from this apparently random cacophony? That was something we'd have to wait much longer to find out. In the meantime, however, something happened which at least at first seemed to offer us some sort of a clue.
An outside telephone call was put through to the science report office. I found myself talking to a man with an American accent. refused to give his name or any other details of himself over the phone. He told me only that he had met Sir William Ballantyne on a visit the British astronomer had made shortly before his death to NASA Space Headquarters in Houston, Texas. We arranged to meet not far from here in 1 hour's time. Okay, I'm ready.
What you are about to see may be considered by many of you unethical. However, we believe that in the light of subsequent developments, our action was justified. Benson was equipped with a miniaturized transmitter so that we could record the conversation between them. And a hidden camera was positioned near the market where the meeting had been arranged.
Colin Benson.
Yes, hello.
Hello. Would you like to go back to
No, no, we're all right here.
This is something I have to know. How far are you going to go on this thing? I mean, all the way.
That's what I'm here for. Can you help?
Oh, I can help. But we do this thing my way, okay?
Okay, fine.
Let's walk on a little bit, okay? I'm sorry if I seem a little bit nervous. It's mainly because I am.
Nervous? What?
Contracting a fatal case of measles, you know what I mean? Like Ballantyne.
You know what happened to him?
I know why it happened. And I gotta get it on record before they find out I'm over here.
Hey, who are they?
Listen, let's just stick to me telling you what I have to tell you, okay?
Okay, come on.
This address tomorrow morning, 10:30. Bring everything you've got. Cameras, tape machines, witnesses. That's the kind of protection I need. I'll have everything for you there.
Colin Benson arrived at the address he was given shortly before 10:30 the next day.
That's it.
Together with a full camera crew.
Okay, drive in.
Eventually, the door was opened. We show you the next part of the film, uncut, and exactly as we shot it on that day.
Retake one.
Who is it?
Anglia Television. Science report.
Who?
This is number 88, isn't it?
Yeah, 88.
We're here with the television crew to see a Mr. Is there an American?
You mean Harry?
That's it. Can we come in, please?
You really are the television.
Thank you.
I don't know what this is all about, but you're not going to get much out of Harry right now.
Come on, lads. Yesterday. You remember?
Oh.
Leave me alone. What's the matter with him?
Get them away from me.
You better go.
Is he on acid or something?
Just get out of here, will you?
Answer our questions.
Yeah. Harry! Oh, Harry! Don't be an idiot! Please!
You do it! Get away!
Please! No! Please!
It was the last we saw of the mysterious young American, despite returning with the police barely half an hour later, who kept watch on this house for several days. We found no one.
Elsewhere, however, more pieces of this strange pattern continued to fit into place. The great world drought of that summer was unequaled in recorded history. Europe's normally green dairy country was reduced to a dust belt. Cattle, finding their moisture in the grass, had to be provided with increasingly scarce water and fed next winter's fodder. In Britain, it was the same story of parched fields and poor crops. In France, forest fires out of control devastated huge areas of woodland. Vast reservoirs dried up, and standpipes were brought into the worst hit areas, some of which had barely 20 days' supply of water left. The River Thames was reduced to its lowest level in living memory. There was no panic, only a growing sense of unease that what we were experiencing was unnatural and that the Earth's climate was moving towards a radical change. Melbourne, Australia, where the Yarra River was reduced to a polluted trickle in which fish and water life were almost completely destroyed. Before water restrictions tightened, desperate efforts were made to save the rare and valuable trees in Melbourne's famous botanical gardens. Northern India was in the grip of the worst heat wave for over 50 years. In Bihar, the temperature reached 48 degrees centigrade, 120 degrees Fahrenheit. Thousands died, and the hardship to animals and crops was unimaginable. The African desert continued its encroachment on fertile land, destroying all in its wake. Meanwhile, in China and the Middle East, unparalleled earthquakes killed millions, far more than might have been expected from a nuclear attack. On the far side of the Pacific, the whole of the Caribbean seemed on the point of eruption. Volcanoes, thought to be extinct for thousands of years, were suddenly erupting into dreadful life. Pressures from shifting land masses in Central Europe destroyed centuries of history. In parts of Italy and Yugoslavia, many ancient towns were reduced to rubble. International rescue teams evacuated thousands from the threatened area, but many others were too broken by the experience to leave. Scientists began to suspect that the balance of the Earth's ecology was far more delicately poised than they'd yet realized. At the height of the drought, we interviewed at Cambridge University someone prepared to offer the beginnings of an answer.
You hear them? Not something you'd expect in this country. Heat, of course.
Gerstein's theories, when he first put them forward over 20 years ago, had been almost universally dismissed. He was called an alarmist and a pessimist. Events proved him, on the contrary, to be something of an optimist. By the late 60s, the Earth was already so trapped within an envelope of its own pollution that heat from the sun and the Earth's industrial processes was having increasing difficulty in escaping. 10 years earlier than Gerstein's prediction, the notorious greenhouse effect, a thickening of the outer atmosphere due to the eightfold increase in the carbon dioxide levels, had become a reality. As the atmosphere became more dense, extreme variations of temperature were experienced, from intense heat to equally unprecedented cold. North America suffered the worst winter on record. Rivers froze solid, and even the great Niagara Falls was halted. In many areas, a state of emergency was ordered by the newly elected President Carter. But the most frightening discovery which scientists made was that last year's unmelted snow line is the next step to a future and unavoidable ice age.
At the Huntsville, Alabama conference of 1957, my ideas were at last being taken seriously by a small group of senior physicists and government advisors. But by then, of course, it was too late. What was this with those people?
Can you tell me what happened at Huntsville?
The usual thing. The politicians come running to us as though we can reverse the course of nature. When we tell them we can't, they say, why didn't we do something earlier? When we tell them they prevented us, they start squabbling among themselves. Oh, rabble.
Was anything achieved by the conference?
There was some discussion. Secret.
Can you tell me anything about that?
It was all very theoretical.
Well, look, I can understand your reluctance.
Look, all I'm prepared to say is there were three alternatives for discussion. The first two were crazy. Forget about them.
The third alternative may be not so crazy. But I don't know whether anything was ever done about it.
Can you tell me what it was? At the time that interview was filmed, Carl Gerstein refused to say anything further about Alternative 3.
In the second part of this special program, we shall show you how we uncovered that information for ourselves. We'll also be bringing you a remarkable interview with former astronaut Bob Grodin, filmed in secret at his hideaway in New England. Stay with us then.
This is astronaut Bob Grodin before his first moonwalk. More than one of the men who were part of that first Apollo program found it difficult to readjust to life back on Earth, but no one more so than this man. Here he is, as he is today. 5 years on. There were psychological factors, it seemed, which on the surface could explain away the changes in personality, the instability, the breakdown of former relationships. But what exactly were those psychological factors? Bravo Tango, Jezebel, a form of code, but meaning what? Certainly nothing to the 600 million people listening on Earth below. From Boston, Massachusetts, we arranged for ex-astronaut Bob Grodin to talk to us. The interview was filmed to be edited later. Can you hear me all right? Can you hear me in Boston?
Yeah, go ahead.
Grodin showed no reluctance to discuss the breakdown he'd suffered after his return from space. But nothing remarkable seemed likely to come from the interview until I asked this question. It's been suggested, among others by some very responsible people, that you, all of you on the Apollo program,
saw far more out there than you've been allowed to admit publicly. Would you like to comment on that suggestion?
What the hell are you trying to do to me? Can I ask you, what the hell are you trying to do to me?
Well, I was only trying
to... You're trying to screw me? Is that what you're trying to do? You're trying to screw me? Like that dumb bastard Ballantyne, is that what you're trying to do? Well, why me? I went up there to do a job, man. That's all I was up there to do. I don't have to answer
questions. Oh, hell. What's the matter with this thing now?
It's not this end. Somebody's pulled a switch somewhere.
That somewhere, so far as we could discover, was neither in London nor in Boston, but in the satellite connecting the two. The incident has never been explained. Nevertheless, that one word, Ballantyne, was enough to send Colin Benson and the camera operator, with some very innocent-looking home movie equipment, across the Atlantic, posing as tourists. This is what they brought back on 8mm film.
I would never have found Bob Grogan unless he had been willing that I should. But starting with the few leads I had, I was brought eventually to the remote bungalow where he now lives. Okay.
You want a beer?
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Just one.
I'll wait.
Annie, can we have a couple of cold beers?
Well, what do you want to do? Do you want to do it out here or in there? It doesn't make any difference. I don't think we're going to have a private conversation.
What's that? Yeah.
Michael, baby, meet the professor.
Hi.
Thank you.
You ever want to reveal all of it? Why, Annie? She's not my daughter, right? You put that on the record. Right?
You got it, Bob.
She's a great kid. Well, without her, I'm pretty lucky.
We talked for an hour before Grodin became willing to discuss our previous and abortive satellite interview.
Let me try that.
Thanks.
What exactly can you tell us about Ballantyne?
What I remember of Ballantyne is he showed up at NASA with some tape he made. And he got pretty damn excited when they put it back in that jukebox.
Jukebox?
Well, the decoder. I mean, you can pick up a signal if you got the equipment, but you can't unscramble that.
Without NASA's equipment?
That's right. And some young guy helped him do it. You should have known better than that.
Was it this man?
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, it looks like him. Are you sure you don't want bourbon?
No, beer's fine. What you're saying is that Ballantyne was killed because of what he discovered on that tape.
Well, I'm saying nothing. I just saw the way that those guys looked at him, and I knew those looks because they looked at me the same way.
Those guys?
Look, come on, get a real drink, will you?
Come on. Okay, Bob. What did happen out there? The moon landing.
Well, we had kind of a big disappointment. We didn't get there first.
What do you mean?
Those layer Apollos, they're just a smoke screen to cover up what's really going on out there. And the bastards, they didn't even tell us. Nothing.
Well, what is going on?
Well, how the hell should I know? You asked the Pentagon, you phoned the Kremlin? After all, they were first out in space. I mean, you don't think they just gave up, do you? Give up? Another drink. You want a drink?
Bob, you got to tell me, what is going on? I mean, what did you see?
Well, we came down the wrong place. And it was crawling. Maybe, but we were on the line of milk one.
You're talking about men from Earth?
Do you think that they need all that crap down in Florida to get two guys up there on a bicycle The hell they do. You know why we're there? To give them a good PR story for all the Hollywood they're shooting out into space. Now, we're nothing. That would... Christ, we're nothing. You know why we're there? To keep you bums happy. Stop you from asking questions about what the hell is really going on out there. Look, that's it. That's it. End of story. That's the finish. That's the word. That's the word. Ready?
Fear, suspicion, unanswered questions, possibly murder. What were we dealing with? Back in London, we did what we could to investigate the claims made by ex-astronaut Bob Grodin. Catherine White reports.
The Institute of International Political Studies is a non-government organization based in London's St. James's. It was Grodin's linking of the Pentagon with the Kremlin and the implications behind it that brought me here to talk to Professor G. Gordon Broadbent, author of a major study of US-Soviet diplomacy since the 1950s.
The short answer is that I know nothing of US-Soviet relations beyond what has already been made public. We had the celebrated docking in space some time ago. This was presented as an isolated exercise, and as far as I know, was exactly that. Maybe paving the way for more to come. Issues of Soviet-US cooperation, there is an element of mystery which puzzles many people in my field. To put it at its simplest, none of us can understand how it is that the peace has been maintained for the past 25 years.
You mean the experts are baffled?
But also, for once, in agreement. The popular myth that it's been proof of the balance of nuclear power doesn't, frankly, hold up entirely. And the more you look at it, the less sense it makes. There are too many imbalances, especially when you put it in the perspective of history.
So what is your explanation?
Essentially, what we're suggesting is that at the very highest level of East-West diplomacy, there is operating a factor of which we know nothing. Now, it could just be, that this unknown factor is a massive but covert operation in space. As for the reason behind it, well, we're not in the business of speculation.
T-minus, guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9, ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, all engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past
the hour. Tower clear. This is the colossal power needed to pull clear from the Earth's gravitational field and put, in Grodin's words, two men on a bicycle on the surface of the moon.
Step off the land, huh? One small
But suppose such immense power did not have to be chiefly consumed in merely getting into space, but could start from space. What kind of travel would that bring within our grasp?
Obviously, we could go further with less power, or send a much larger craft. In fact, the only way we're going to see space travel on any scale is by this kind of extraterrestrial launching. For instance, from a space platform orbiting the Earth.
Or the Moon.
Sure, yeah. If we could get the material there to build the craft, it'd make real good sense.
Could we transport the materials there?
It'd take one hell of a shuttle, but yeah. We have the machines now. In theory, we could do it. Especially if we had some sort of international cooperation.
International cooperation in space. A space shuttle. But shuttling what to where? We also hear talk of Russian and American sky labs and the men who live and work in them for several months at a time. But what are they all doing up there in space? We tend to think of the arms race and the space race as practically the same thing. Visits by one side to the other, here Soviet technicians and astronauts are greeted by their American counterparts, have been dismissed as diplomatic courtesies.
We have a working relationship that's quite good with the Soviet Union. I'm sure it's going to continue.
But the Russians were the first in space with their Sputnik in 1957. And later the same year, the first with a living creature, Laika, the dog. Then they made, 3 years later, the gigantic step with the first man in space, Yuri Gagarin. And later on, the first woman, Valentina. The drive to make the first man on the moon an American was launched by President Kennedy.
The first wave of modern invention and the first wave of nuclear power. And this generation does not intend to founder in the backwash of the coming age of space. We mean to be a part of it. We mean to lead it.
By the late 60s, the Russians, it seemed, had simply dropped out and stopped trying. And yet today, Cape Canaveral is virtually abandoned, a desert of reinforced concrete and steel. The most ambitious project in the history of mankind seemed to be over. Are we to believe that this is where it all ends? Of the estimated 2,000 launchings from Earth to space, at least 60% have been by the Russians. The near side of the moon's surface, the side visible to us here on Earth. The flags indicate acknowledged landings of American and Soviet craft. Among the spaceships the Russians sent up was the Vostok, supposedly not intended to reach the moon's surface. But in 1972, this sighting was recorded.
More detail, please. Can you give more detail of what you are seeing?
It's something flashing. It's all so far. It's a light going on and off on the edge of the crater.
Can you give the coordinates?
Well, there's something there. Maybe a little further down.
It couldn't be a Vostok, could it?
Well, I can't be sure. It's possible.
The Russian Vostok flights took place in the early 60s. They were, as we've said, Earth-orbiting spaceships, not designed to reach the moon. So what are we to make of this casual suggestion by Houston Mission Control and an equally casual acceptance by the Lunar Module pilot that in 1972, an obsolete Russian spaceship is orbiting the moon, flashing its lights? The Russians were the first on the moon with their unmanned rocket, which landed here in 1959. Here, exactly 10 years later, Neil Armstrong landed. But our researches show another pattern of landings. On the far side of the moon, the dark side, the side hidden from us here on Earth. Are we to assume that this remarkable grouping of American and Soviet landings is mere coincidence? When we returned to Cambridge and presented Dr. Carl Gerstein with the information we'd so far acquired, he finally agreed to speak on record about alternative three.
We had agreed at the Huntsville conference that there was nothing we could do to cut either world population or the consumption of resources essential for survival on Earth. Alternative three was a much more limited option. It was an attempt to ensure that at least some of the human race survived the consequences. We were theorists, not technicians, but we realized we were talking about a kind of space travel which had only appeared in scientific fiction so far.
What, you mean go to some other planet?
I mean get the hell off this one whilst there's still time.
Dr. Carl Gerstein then went on to discuss the kind of cross-section they would like to see get away. A balance of the sciences and the arts. In fact, all aspects, as far as possible, of human culture. He said that the list would never be complete, but it would be better than nothing. These are the cards you saw earlier. All of them people who've disappeared without trace or explanation during the last 18 months. In other countries, they have similar lists. All people forming that same kind of cross-section that Carl Gerstein described. All were in good health, and all under the age 55. But where have they gone? Here is a picture of a supposedly dead planet, the nearest one to Earth. Mars would appear to offer little prospect of survival if these photographs from Viking 2 are to be believed. But are they? Charles Wellborn himself seemed surprised that the Americans, after spending so much money in putting the probe on the surface of Mars, should then equip it with a camera that only focused up to 100 meters, or, as Colin Benson suggested, the average size of a large film studio.
What's your answer?
Well, you got to remember that all these pictures that we get come in through NASA, and then they're given to the rest of us. If they say it's Mars, we have to believe them. It's the same thing with audio. I mean, we don't hear everything that's said between mission control and the spacecraft. There's a second channel. They call it the biological channel. Officially, it's just for reporting on medical details. In effect, it's the one they switch to when they have something to say they don't want the whole world to listen in on. I mean, sure, that could be a studio in Burbank. But I mean, for God's sake.
Mariner 4 passed close enough to Mars to send back the best photographs of its surface we've had so far. But was it all just like this?
Mars has always been a source of fascination to mankind. And a mystery. In the early days of astronomy, Mars was believed to have artificially constructed canals, which was taken as evidence of intelligent life on the planet. Later, this theory was discredited. In its place, we had a picture of barren, inhospitable planet, inimical to the survival of any form of life. Then, more recently, an interesting idea was put forward. Suppose life had existed on Mars. As the climate and other conditions worsened, any surviving life would have formed into a state of hibernation, awaiting the return of more favorable conditions. It was even suggested that the atmosphere which had sustained life may have become entrapped in the surface soil of the planet. There was an occurrence several years ago which made this theory very persuasive.
Mars has always had a covering of cloud, varying in density at different times, until the time of which Dr. Gerstein spoke, when the cloud thickened to a degree never previously observed. This happened, and was scientifically recorded, in 1961. It was obvious that storms of colossal proportions were taking place on Mars. When the clouds eventually cleared, some remarkable changes were seen. The polar ice caps had substantially decreased in size, and around the equatorial regions, a broad band of darker colouring had appeared. This, it has been suggested, was vegetation. Carl Gerstein's theory was that these storms could have been caused by a nuclear explosion delivered from Earth.
The same year, the Russians had a great space disaster. Only the barest facts are recorded, the rest was kept secret. A rocket blew up at launching. Numbers of people were killed, large area devastated. What were the Russians trying to launch, and did they succeed? Was the rocket carrying a nuclear device, which would account for the devastation caused, a nuclear device which at a second attempt was delivered to the surface of Mars, causing the dynamic changes recorded in 1961?
48 hours ago, Catherine White was at her desk in the production office.
As a matter of course by now, all incoming phone calls were recorded.
Hello, science report. Can I speak to Tim Brinton or Colin Benson? I'm afraid they're not here just now. Who is it, please? Can you get a message to them? Yes, I can. Just tell them the girl who is with Harry. Tell them I'm back at the house and to get here fast. And bring cameras. I'm not talking except on record, okay?
What happened to Harry?
I don't know. They promised me that if I throw you off the
track... Well, who are
they? Listen, Harry wanted you to have this. I've no idea what it is. Please, you've got to get me somewhere to hide.
Don't worry, we'll do that.
I've no idea what it... I don't know what it does.
It's a printed circuit.
He said that you had to fit it to, an IC something 40.
Yes.
And you get a jukebox. Does that mean anything?
We've heard of it.
And he said that you've got to, play back Ballantyne's tape. That's all.
We connected up the printed circuit and played once again the videotape that Sir William Ballantyne, before his death, had sent to his friend, John Hendry. This time, we obtained an acceptable picture, which you're now about to see as we saw it. We believe that to be an authentic record of the first and secret landing on Mars by an unmanned space probe from Earth. We also believe the date given, May the 22nd, 1962, to be accurate. Clearly, the blanket of total security by which this information has been covered could only have been maintained by the active cooperation of governments at very high level. Equally clearly, there must have been powerful reasons why the true conditions on Mars, suitable as they appear to be for human habitat, have been kept secret. Indeed, the effort which has gone into persuading the rest of the world that the opposite is true argues that some operation of supreme importance has been going on beneath the security cover. We believe that that operation is Dr. Carl Gerstein's Alternative 3. Whether a human survival colony has already been established on Mars, or whether plans are still in preparation for its transportation from the Moon to Mars, we don't know. But we put out this program tonight as a challenge to those who do know to tell us the truth. We regret if the implications of what you've seen are less than optimistic for the future of life on this planet. It has been our task, however, to present the facts as we understand them and to await the response. Good night.